Saga Egmont presents The Melodramatists by Howard Nemerov and read by Kelly Burke. If I should undertake to write in praise of a gentlewoman, I would neither praise her crystal eye nor her cherry lip, etc., for these things are trite et obvia. But I would either find some supernatural cause whereby my pen might walk in the superlative degree, or else I would undertake to answer for any imperfection that she hath, and thereupon raise the praise of her commendation. George Gascoigne. A Note on the Melodramatists by William Mills. Perhaps understandably, Howard Nemerov's reputation as a fiction writer is sometimes overshadowed by his very great reputation as a poet. After all, he was our third poet laureate, and the many prizes awarded him, which include the National Book Award, the Pulitzer, and the Bollingen, were substantially for his poetry. He was, however, a man of letters, one who, for example, has written a body of criticism so lucid and insightful as to be envied by those who solely pursue that activity. The same wit and mind imbue the fiction. The Melodramatists, his first novel, appeared in 1949, 2 years after his first book of poems. It opened to mixed reviews, one of which by Diana Trilling describes it as a considerable first novel, literate and entertaining, with a nice satiric barb. The time of the novel is 1940 to 1941, prior to the American entrance into the war. The setting is a restricted one, somewhat in the manner of Jane Austen, most of the novel taking place in a single house, with infrequent excursions by the characters to an apartment or a bar in Boston. The central action of the novel is never attenuated by distant minor actions, but is intensified by the dramatic irony of a macro world going to pieces outside Boston, while the one of our story disintegrates center stage. The father, Mr. Boyne, remonstrating with his son Roger, who wants to divorce his wife, remarks, "For a while I thought the country might go to war to help Britain. That would have been a horrible mistake, a direct contravention of the Monroe Doctrine. But you would have been in the army. In the army they would have smartened you up, I'll say. But there'll be no war for us. We learned last time when we're well out of it." A little further in the same chapter, Roger thinks to himself, "It was funny to see that they were both offering up Leonora, his wife, on the altars of an armed truce. Rather, he thought, like Munich." The first chapter opens on a scene that suggests a novel of manners. The members of a wealthy family are having dinner in their Boston mansion. The reader is quickly taken into the middle of a domestic quarrel precipitated by Roger's intention to divorce Leonora. Straight away, Nemerov the satirist sets up contrasts, the first of which, ironically, couples wealth with misery. "When Claire's mother wept, as she did now, all the jewels on her fingers and at her throat winked in sparkling connivance, as at a joke which, they seemed to say, you too might appreciate were you as detached as stone, cold as this sapphire, hard and cutting as this diamond." Mrs. Boyne's tears fell heedlessly where they might, into her coffee, over the bright little spoons and dessert knives, stained the damask cloth. Her back rose and fell in genteel, choking spasms. The little jewels caught the light and flashed with a terrible brilliancy. Other contrasts are manifest. No one seems concerned about Roger's troubles, only about appearances. Mr. Boyne worries about the public scandal that reflects private weakness, and Uncle Fred, also at the dinner, and running for state senator, worries simply about the public scandal. I would like to call special attention to the jewels that wink in sparkling connivance as at a joke, which, they seemed to say, you too might appreciate were you as detached as stone. One way to read the Melodramatists is as one large, complicated joke. From what we have read about or by Nemerov, we know that he takes jokes seriously. To the charge by some literary critics that his fictions and poems are jokes, even bad jokes, he responded in an essay, "I incline to agree," insisting, however, that they are bad jokes and even terrible jokes, emerging from the nature of things as well as from my propensity for coming at things a touch subversively and from the blind side or the dark side, the side everyone concerned with values would just as soon forget. Mrs. Boyne's jewels wink at her maudlin, melodramatic behavior. The reader winks at Mr. Boyne's melodramatic behavior when he cries at his son, "Don't be melodramatic with me, young man." It is commonly observed that we joke about the most serious, most sensitive areas of our experience: sex, insanity, affliction, religion, death, and some kind of permissible release of the tension that we feel toward them. And indeed, Nemerov seems to cover the spectrum in this novel. The domineering Mr. Boyne, after an accident, becomes a megalomaniac who, as he spends his hours soaking in a bathtub at a rest home, thinks he is God. The religious impulses of Claire culminate in the sexual debacle at the end of the story, with Episcopalians and Roman Catholics catching the brunt of the satire. And psychiatry comes in for a full-scale assault through the characters of Susan and Dr. Einman. Nemerov obviously created the fascinating, enigmatic Dr. Einman, the analytical psychologist, with a great deal of zest. The good doctor is a refugee from Auschwitz who has started a new practice in Boston and concurrently is working on a study entitled Eros and Agape. He sleeps with many of his women patients, makes extensive notes on them for his study, and in fact seems to do many of them some good. While it is true that psychiatry, along with institutional religion, receives its lumps from Nemerov, the character of Dr. Einman is much more complexly drawn than that of, say, the Jesuit, Claire's spiritual director. The portrait of the Jesuit is almost entirely negative, whereas there is much that is appealing about Einman. There is a deeper humanity about him, a humanity that reveals a vacillation similar to that of his patients, permitting him to ridicule himself, even if his self-deprecation may have the ulterior motive of swaying Susan to care for him. He says to her, "Now suppose instead that I am not a laughing psychiatrist with bound volumes of Imago and Freud's Gesamte Werke all over the place to give the patient confidence that I already know what's what. Suppose, and you can easily imagine it, I'm a criminal and irresponsible fraud, an unholy fake, as I am." He has been created clearly as no magus, but someone flawed. There is enough about his roguishness to endear him to the reader. The creation of Einman is just one example of Nemerov's powers of negative capability. The scene in which Claire undergoes a religious experience is another. Regardless of what the author's feelings about such experiences are, he evokes this state of mind very convincingly. The reader wants, finally, of course, to feel with some certainty where the author wants to lead him, where he will be left, in order to ponder the total action. It is at this point that some readers feel uncertain about how to take the novel. If one expects a satirist who is implicitly convinced of an inherited norm, and whose ridicule makes this norm clear, then he will be uneasy with Nemerov. But after all, isn't this an attribute of modernity, the deprivation or disinheritance of many such historical norms? In view of the final action, one might be forced to conclude that religious mischief is less lethal than psychoanalytic mischief, if one assumes that Susan aided in pulling the trigger. After all, Claire is left playing a fugue on the harpsichord, and the remaining voices show an inexorable confidence in their not-quite-harmonious world. The shooting, however, is left ambiguous. The shifting perspective may be a source of dissatisfaction for those who insist on absolutes, yet it is typical of the satirist to show the world that values have been turned on their heads and what is up should be down. Boston leaders and town fathers are debauchees, and the church and psychiatry, principal instruments of help and guidance, are hypocritical and ineffective. Hogan, a mini rogue, is the first to be moved to tears in the final scene, and Mother Fosker, the cat house madam, is not only what she appears to be, but in Hogan's words, he had never met with a mind so certain of itself, so acute, and so limited. She has no pretensions, yet she is an instrument for what we sometimes call love. Her character reminds us of a speech by Susan early in the story. So it seems to me we're all being victimized by our own pretenses, pretending that we can do this and keep from doing that, and that it's all a matter of willpower and, well, education, when really we may be just blind activities started by two other blind activities having what they call fun. Pretense is ever the target of the satirist. Nemerov, in this tour de force, has produced a species of what Northrop Frye called menopean satire, which fingers pretentious wise men whose very erudition renders them absurd. As the pretension is stripped away, the reader laughs, but it is a painful laugh, for something of himself has also been revealed. Such pretenders can and do cause much pain, and it is this pain and disease, this relation between spirit and desire, that Nemerov probes so relentlessly. In a line beginning with Nietzsche, through Freud and Thomas Mann, his path follows the conviction that investigations and the suffering of pain and disease lead to deeper knowledge. One side of such investigations and satire is moral, but there is another side that is beyond good and evil, where there are no guarantees about the revelations. Several of the characters in the novel insist that whatever love may be, it is founded on the erotic experience, and to miss that point leads to much mischief, to pain and sickness. The final effect of the melodramatists is to create a clearing, a leveling of the ground, where we may begin again. For Margaret. The action takes place in Boston from the winter of 1940 to the autumn of 1941. Book 1. Chapter 1. There was to Claire something invincibly embarrassing about the sight of misery coupled with riches, bringing momentarily to the surface a childhood memory of the parental retreat behind closed doors, whence issued the confused, unlikely noise of sobbing and recrimination. When her mother wept, as she did now, all the jewels on her fingers and at her throat winked in sparkling connivance, as at a joke which, they seemed to say, you too might appreciate were you as detached as a stone, cold as this sapphire, hard and cutting as this diamond. Mrs. Boyne's tears fell heedlessly where they might, into her coffee, over the bright little spoons and dessert knives, stained the damask cloth. Her back rose and fell in genteel, choking spasms. The little jewels caught the light and flashed with a terrible brilliancy. The worst of it, Claire thought, was that nothing could be said, done. People are not equipped to handle dinner parties and outraged emotion at once. They sit like a community stricken with paralysis, or as the disciples must have sat, thunderstruck, when Judas had the bad grace to ask, Lord, is it I? She looked at her sister. But Susan, though she sat with abased eyes, seemed undeceived and apart. Claire thought she could detect complacency even to contempt, to the trace of a smile. This was infuriating, for Claire realized her own embarrassment to be the function of her identification with the milieu. She was ashamed not even for her mother's sake, but for the betrayal, as she felt, of this material environment. These rich and old things which existed, so far as concerned her conscience, to give happiness to whoever could afford it. But Susan patently felt no such allegiance to the perfectly genuine George III silver, the Caravaggio above the oaken sideboard, or even to the butler, Hogan, who imitated now almost to parody the perfect servant, seeing, hearing nothing. For Claire, Susan was almost disgracefully at ease where anxiety would have been respectful and even appropriate. She had the self-sufficiency of a cat, regarding with dour amusement the improbably genuine tears of some ophidian monster. As was not unusual in this family, the occasion was somewhat trivial, and the scene semi-public. Besides Mr. and Mrs. Boyne and the three children, Roger, Claire, and Susan, there were present Uncle and Aunt Fred Seeley and a lawyer, a not very intimate associate of Uncle Fred Seeley's, who had been invited at the last moment because he was in town just for the night. This lawyer, named Barspaw, was naturally not pleased to find himself in the midst of a family quarrel. He did not know these people, he told himself. He found them rude. He did not like quarrels. Surely they might have chosen a more appropriate time. To relieve his embarrassment, he tried to derive a civilized entertainment from the dispute, stating dryly to himself the rights and wrongs of the matter, drawing up for practice a brief for both sides at once. To aid his thinking, he drew little marks on the cloth with the tines of a dirty fork, which he had unwittingly concealed when the main course was cleared away. He began by making a mark for each reason, to the right, to the left. But as his attention began to wander, he became attracted by the designs it was possible to make by using all four tines simultaneously. In the vast backwoods of his mind, a child pretended to be plowing a snow-covered field. "While the plowman near at hand whistles o'er the furrowed land," he cried silently, feeling the cool wind on his cheek, and was content. But by words, by tears, the debate raged. The substance of it was this, that Roger intended to divorce Lee. Since he had married her 2 years before, against the wishes of his parents, it might be thought that his present decision would evoke at most a mild rebuke along the lines of, "Perhaps you'll listen to your poor stupid parents next time, eh?" And even a secret jubilation over the fact that, in the long run, which is always exactly as long as time requires to prove something, their calamitous prophecies and threatful warnings had been entirely justified. But this would be to reckon without the special characteristics of the people involved, so that for Mrs. Boyne, the crux of the matter was Roger's leaving that poor helpless girl without a word of explanation. Mr. Boyne saw the public scandal reflected from the shameful and private weakness. Uncle Fred Seeley, who wished to become state senator in the next year, saw simply the public scandal. Susan was distantly amused, though she found the concentrated venom of the charges on both sides unclean, like the sudden eruption of an established disease to the surface of the skin. And Claire, in scrupulous anguish, saw a collapse of the glittering surface of things, and beneath, the abyss boiling with tribal savageries. As for Roger, possessed as he was of a callowness too natural to be outgrown, he had chosen the worst possible moment for his revelation. Unable to contain himself for 5 minutes, he had come out, while the soup was being served, with possibly the last dispassionate statement he was to make that evening.
"Mother, I have decided to divorce Leonora."
To Claire, the quavering stiffness apparent in his posture and voice at once emphasized the comic period piece aspect of the matter. His little speech, so obviously prepared in just this formula, parodied the righteousness it was supposed to contain and called in question the scene itself. As though the fourth wall had folded back, they were exposed to the obscene laughter of an audience, as certainly as on a stage they sat in a room where such things are said. But Susan laughed outright, causing Mrs. Boyne to say in a sharp voice which trembled slightly,
"I don't see anything to laugh about, Susan."
And Mr. Boyne said, with a wealth of squirine authority,
We will discuss this after dinner, Roger. It is not a matter for the table.
So Hogan continued to serve the soup, which was vichyssoise, and they began the meal in a kind of dry anger, all of them, mitigated only by the admiration of each for his own tact. Mr. Boyne, like most men who appreciate fully the sound of their own voices, quite looked forward to having a man-to-man talk with his son, particularly, he intended, when he should have learned the grounds for divorce, if they were what he felt they must be, to establish himself on a firm footing of masculine and adult superiority with his son, whom he regarded, not without reason, as a child.
"I do not want to hear your confessions," he fancied himself as saying, with a wry, ironical smile. "But you must know I'll get to the bottom of this thing one way or another, so we may as well be reasonable."
Being reasonable, in the family vocabulary, covered a number of devices of discourse, none of them distinguished by logic. Meanwhile, as he knew well, every moment that delayed the interview made more improbable this rounded and, on the whole, literary approach, replacing it by the automatic anger that he felt both as abhorring divorce and, more particularly, as hating any disturbance, especially if it involved problems of a sexual nature. His contempt for what he called smut was compulsive and, in its way, salacious. Mrs. Boyne, for her part, could not bear the realization that her husband intended to exclude her from the reasonings, diplomacies, causeries that would attend upon the discussion, and she wished desperately to be able to say something now that would show her complete understanding and command, and thus prevent all interested parties from leaving her out of their calculations. Something it had to be that would place her clearly where she belonged, at the center of things, meeting a matriarchal justice. Silently, while she chewed her food, she searched her mind for an entrance and a cue. Mr. Barspaw, the lawyer, felt the terrible hostility around him and tried to consider whether he might not have given cause for displeasure. Mention of the divorce had not at once struck him as a sufficient reason for the sullenness of his hosts. Divorce, marriage, death, he thought. A will, a litigation, an appearance in church or in court. And his mind moved gently over stacks of yellowing paper with which he was perfectly familiar. So he examined his clothing to make sure it was completely buttoned, ascertained that his hat was not still on his head, that he had not spilled anything, that his napkin was on his lap. When, after making this check, he looked at Susan, he saw that she was smiling straight at or through him, and he became quite flustered indeed, so much so that when the main course was cleared, he found himself with one dirty fork left over. It was just at this time that Mrs. Boyne leaned over her plate and began to sob.
"You see," Mr. Boyne said to Roger, "you have upset your mother so she cannot eat."
This was not true, for Mrs. Boyne's plate was not only empty but very nearly clean. Nevertheless, as no one dared mention this fact, the point was scored.
"I can't help it," said Roger, "but I can't go on like this."
"Don't be melodramatic with me, young man," cried the father, half rising from his chair as Roger, too, threatened to break into tears.
From childhood, Roger had cried when reproached, easily and automatically, as a defense and a gesture of obedience which often saved him the worst part of punishment. Now, he said, his voice tremulous with self-pity,
"If you knew all the facts, maybe you wouldn't be so anxious to blame me."
Mr. Barspaw made a line with his fork on Roger's side this time. Mrs. Boyne wept while her plate was taken away.
"Come, come," said Uncle Fred Seeley. "It's few of these lovers' quarrels can't be patched up somehow."
"Many perfect matches go on the rocks after a year," said Mr. Barspaw, as though with statistical accuracy.
He was using all four tines now, far away on the snowy hills where the milkmaid singeth blithe. Hogan began now to bring in the dessert, baba o'rum, in little individual saucers and coffee.
There was no warning,
Mrs. Boyne gasped between sobs.
We thought you were so perfectly happy.
The facts, Roger said again, and paused suggestively on the edge of this timorous threat.
The silence was marked metronomically by Mrs. Boyne's emotion. Sob, snuffle, sob, snuffle. It was, Claire thought, the operatic moment. The recitative stops. The orchestra goes tum-tim-tim, tum-tim-tim, and in a moment the tenor will begin with the obvious reflection, la donna mobile. Enter the facts dressed like furies. They dance.
Hogan, said Mr. Boyne. That'll be all for now.
Sir?
Hogan looked inquiringly at his employer and held up ritually, as though in symbol of his office and obedience, the little instrument used for scraping crumbs.
Sir?
I mean, go into the kitchen. I shall ring when you're needed again.
But the dessert, sir, and the coffee. Two people, sir, including Miss Susan.
I said, go into the kitchen.
In the silence, all watched Hogan turn smartly about and march into the kitchen. Before the swinging door settled to behind him,
My Christ,
they heard him say to Mrs. Purse, the cook, and heard her also reply,
Shut up and listen. I got the oven to do.
Needs discipline, that man of yours,
said Uncle Fred Seely.
What do you suggest? The whip? Susan asked.
I must apologize,
Mr. Boyne began, bending courteously toward Mr. Barspaw,
for having subjected you in my house.
Ah,
Mr. Barspaw startled, recalled himself, and put down the fork.
Ah, it is nothing, sir, nothing. Pray do not. That is to say, I was about to suggest myself that I withdraw until a more...
He got up and edged, bowing toward the door, throwing them easily the glib and final phrase,
propitious moment.
Wait, please.
Roger got up too.
You're a lawyer.
You must know, how long will it take me to get a divorce?
Mr. Barspaw stopped.
Well,
he replied with clarity and precision,
that depends. You have grounds, of course.
We have grounds, fine, medium, and coarse, thought Susan, in a momentary collapse of perspective. Percolate, drip, silex.
Of course I have grounds,
said Roger.
Goddamn good grounds.
He felt obscurely and correctly that anger might improve his position, and certainly it did wonders for his tone. Mr. Barspaw sidled gently back toward the table, where he gripped devoutly the back of his chair, and, with head bowed, seemed ready to recite a grace.
Now, Roger.
Mr. Boyne prepared to make a diversion by noise alone, but too late. Roger had already said the word.
Adultery, precisely.
Mr. Barspaw was playing on his home grounds now. He picked up a dessert spoon and twiddled it as expertly as if it had been a pencil.
Adultery, yes.
He gave the impression of musing, priest-like, upon frailty. Now, as though to elicit a confession by shock, he raised his head and said crisply,
Whose?
Why, hers, of course. Leonora's.
It was, Susan felt, like a desperately bad movie in which the actors do not respond to a situation until it has been six ways made clear to the audience. Now Mrs. Boyne caught her breath, choked momentarily, then wept with renewed vigor. Uncle Fred Seely allowed his orator's smooth face to express astonishment and his orator's mouth to hang limply open, while Aunt Emma Seely, who was deaf and a little feeble in the head, smiled in her most charming manner.
Mr. Boyne stood up.
I think, he said, you will excuse Roger and myself if we go upstairs.
As they pushed back their chairs, they heard Hogan, like a chorus leader, speak behind the kitchen door.
This is only the beginning, he intoned. Only the beginning. They're going upstairs now. Good night, all,
said Mr. Barspaw in a cheery, professional voice, like that of a doctor leaving a house of mortal sickness.
Good night.
And, like a doctor, too, he gave a final word to the patient to speed him on his journey.
Good night, young man,
he said to Roger, just one whole tone lower. 2. After Mr. Boyne had followed Roger upstairs, Mrs. Boyne, like a commander left in charge of garrison while the crack squadron goes forth to battle, led her remaining cohorts, the aged, the infirm, women and children, through the Seicento Plaza, with the fountain that did not work, into the library cum parlor. This was a massive, overbearing room, paneled in walnut stained almost to black and insufficiently illuminated by lights set in gilded wooden sconces along the wall, so that the ceiling, which was quite low, received the best part of the light, while the habitable part of the room rested under the bulging shadows of scrolled woodwork. The furniture was a hodgepodge of styles and degrees of comfort, slim chairs that would not bear the weight of Uncle Fred Seeley, bespoke the room of some great courtesan or her maid. But this impression was contradicted by other chairs, enormous, deep, and heavily stuffed, and a fat sofa covered in heavy purple velvet. Many of the pieces, moreover, seemed to have been practice fields for the mythological fancies of their creators. On them, fertile invention had entwined maidens with serpents, with vines, had set warriors fully armed, had in a multitude of ways advantaged itself of the one constant fashion of making things resemble what they are not, so that the unwary visitor, throwing himself back in a chair, was liable to severe damage from the keen aquiline nose of a nymph or helmeted Amazon, designed perhaps with the sinister intention of being tipped with poison and penetrating the base of the skull. Every so often, Mrs. Boyne decided that this room should be made more gay, and in consequence had several pieces recovered in brightly striped or patterned silks. The resulting gaiety always proved discouraging enough to cause the idea to be dropped. The bright little chairs against the heavy paneling produced an effect at once fey and unwholesome. Several bookcases, filled with leather-bound standard editions of the best authors, were let into the paneling at equal intervals along the walls. In one corner there stood a harpsichord, lacquered in red and black. Alert and delicate on spindly legs, this instrument supported two things, a silver peacock with tail upspread, and a cast of the bust of Plato in the Vatican. The philosopher's brow was ever so slightly creased, his mouth turned ever so little down at the corners, into the stylized mustache which flowed past his chin to the tip of the beard. Mrs. Boyne, as leaning on Claire's arm, she directed the seating of the company, was thinking that perhaps some decision might yet be reached without the aid of the principal parties. It may be possible, thought she, to present, if not a fait accompli, at least the decision of a large part of the family, without knowing very many of the facts, to be sure. But then, facts were so seldom important, she found, compared to an innate predisposition to do the right thing. First, however, she must allow herself time to develop the adequate appearance of one who recovers by simple strength from a grievous blow. Claire, she said, disengaging herself and sitting down heavily in an armchair. Claire, play something for us, something nice. There was a dutiful fidgeting, then a devout or uninterested silence on Uncle Fred Seeley's part as Claire sat down at the harpsichord. Mrs. Boyne sighed loudly, almost a groan, above the music. The only person who listened to Claire while she played, competently, the B-flat partita, was Aunt Emma Seeley. And curiously, Claire was the only person who thought at the time of this old lady, who sat stiffly upright in the uncomfortable chair assigned to her, not listening, perhaps, so much as attentive with her whole being, attentive in more than the poise of her small head on her gross, shapeless body, in more than the vacant fixture of her alert, meaningless eyes. The clangor of the instrument might have meant for her the noise of men rattling garbage cans in some street where she had lived, or the tinkle of many silver spoons being cleaned and put away. For Claire, she represented one of the worst of life's many dangers, something hard to name but which she called the obesity of utter disappointment. It was as though she had said to her body, "Come, there's nothing else for us. Let us grow, let us triumph, at any rate, over space." In her, all capacity had been strangled save the vegetative, which by some impertinent freakishness had allowed to remain uncamouflaged by fat the bird-like, unhappy features, which, some said, had once been handsome and more than handsome. Occasionally, it was remarked that Uncle Fred had been a little heavy-handed with her in their first years of marriage. Originally, Claire had thought this meant to beat her, but she soon learned from Susan, who had a way of picking up the oddest confidences about the family from comparative strangers, that with a subtlety unlooked for in a man of his size and habits, Uncle Fred had simply insisted on her drinking much more than was good for her. By conviviality, prescriptions of port for health, pretending offense if she did not drink with himself glass for glass, he had kept her in a state of moderate alcoholic stupidity accompanied by diarrhea, until, when one day he turned on her and diagnosed her case as feeble-mindedness, her fuddled brain took the suggestion and progressively relaxed its control to meet her lord and master's description. No one knew why Uncle Fred had behaved this way in his youth. Now, in public at least, he was careful and considerate of the silly old woman. Much in the world frightened Claire, but most of all the contemplation of the number of wicked things people might do and still not merely live on, but preserve as well their social position and the esteem in which they were held among their acquaintance. Sometimes she was frightened of Susan for this cause. Susan seemed to understand so well about time and its modifying effect on action, how time was a desert in which the lineaments of decisive acts crumbled or got covered, lost in sand, and seemed ready to accept this, even take it for granted, a concession which Claire could not by any means make. Sometimes she felt that one's potential for disaster grew with one, or grew even faster, far faster, and when she looked into the future, she saw but two alternatives, a strict negative volition, a will not to do, or swift catastrophe, not killing at once, but leaving her to the quiet, often offensively humorous depredations of time, while there grew up a new, cruel generation that would not understand. She had reached the sarabande, which she played well indeed. The two clear levels of music, of elegant, melancholy rhetoric, rose into the room with a splendid metallic resonance. It seemed the purest emotion of the storyteller, the crisp rendering into the present, into the moment, of a sad tale from the past.
"Very nice, Claire," said Mrs. Boyne, before the second repeat could be played. "Very nice indeed." She clapped her hands delicately.
"I don't know why you don't get a piano," said Uncle Fred Seeley. "That thing there, every time I hear it, I think it's a pretty expensive get-up for something that sounds like a banjo."
"It's a harpsichord, Fred," said Mrs. Boyne, as she had said many times before. "It's very old." Now her bland expression, suitable for music, became a bleak, forbidding mask, and she said, "I must apologize to you all for my slight lapse in there."
She motioned toward the dining room.
But I was, excusably, I think, overcome by shock. Now I have recovered sufficiently to consider with you what must be done.
Really, Mother, Susan said, I think Roger has decided pretty definitely what must be done.
Susan, I ask that you must not take sides with Roger. That's the trouble with you young people. You have not the slightest sense of responsibility. You like to be considered, yes, but you do not consider others. Your family means nothing to you, nothing whatever. You have very little regard for a reputation built up over a century and a quarter.
There is no telling how long this might have continued, had not Mrs. Boyne realized herself to have been entrapped in a filibuster. She stopped, and after a moment resumed from her beginning, in the tones of authentic, impartial justice.
Whatever is being decided upstairs, she said, need not be taken as final. You will admit, Fred, that you men will always join forces against a woman.
She should be spanked,
said Uncle Fred Seeley suddenly, referring presumably to Leonora. He finished with an abrupt laugh as he saw Susan flash him a glance which said quite clearly, I'd like to see you try it, too. His face reddened slightly, and he tried without success to stare the girl down.
After all, he said with dignity, misbehaving is misbehaving.
Exactly, said Mrs. Boyne. Now I say, even if Roger is my own son, that whatever Leonora did, she had good reason, or else she was driven to it.
She presented these alternatives with an air of finality, like the salesman who asks whether you will have the large or the small package. The curious feature of her attitude was an apparently complete forgetfulness of the fact that she had always disliked Leonora, and until now, a grudging element had always been foremost in her acceptance of the marriage. Inasmuch as she acted reasonably, two reasons might be found. First, because of a strong tension between herself and her children, any stick would do to beat any of them. And second, whatever happened in the end, Roger would remain to be beaten, while Leonora quite possibly would not. If there were no divorce, on the other hand, if all were forgiven, Mrs. Boyne would commend her own fair-mindedness in shifting a large part of the blame to Leonora simply because she had again become accessible. Now, as she developed her thesis, she claimed that Roger's unfortunate financial dependence on his parents must prove irksome to a girl of Leonora's spirit, which previously she had called the impudence of that girl, that her discontent might easily have led to some harmless indiscretion. She's still just a girl, marriage or no marriage. That whatever she might have done had been intended merely as a criticism of Roger. And in short, before concluding her exposition, she had made of the adultery,
if there was any such thing,
this with all the propriety of great doubt,
which I don't for a moment admit,
a mere spur to Roger's pride, a way of making him a great success by simple compensation, which success once made, Leonora would live safe again at home, never more to roam from beside her industrious and suddenly mature, important husband, a lay figure in which no trace was to be found of Roger in his proper person as he was. What nonsense, Claire thought. What precious nonsense. She looked at her watch, then up at Susan, and shook her head very slightly toward the door. Susan, with an expression of the gravest interest in what was going on, affected not to notice.
We must do everything we can to keep them together, concluded Mrs. Boyne, looking triumphantly and challengingly at Uncle Fred Seeley. What do you think? She wanted to know.
Uncle Fred, for his part, was torn by two desires. The wish not to give in to any woman in her slightest request was balanced by the wish to prevent, if he could, the publicity attendant on a divorce in the family. One had, he put it to himself, a position to keep up, the respect of the community. While he considered how to phrase acceptably these sentiments, He sat bolt upright in a judicial posture, with his arms extended on the carved arms of a dignified oak chair. For some time he had been tracing with his fingertips the lineaments of the carvings, and now, looking curiously down, he discovered himself to have been fondling all this while the round breast and sharply erected nipple of a nymph. With a sudden movement, he dropped both hands in his lap and looked quickly and furtively about him. Obviously, he saw, Susan had been watching him for some time. A slight contemptuous smile played on her lips, and Uncle Fred felt himself shaken by a remote, entirely sexual thrill of hatred. He would like, he thought, to
paddle her bottom for her.
Yes, that was it, to paddle her bottom. The fine old manly phrase barely served to cover, in Uncle Fred's mind, Caligulan dreamlike lecheries that made sleep so attractive to him. He was roused from a consideration of these practices upon Susan's remarkably nubile body by the voice of Mrs. Boyne, who demanded to know for the third time what he thought. Nervously weakened by the diversion of his strongest emotions into such distant ways, Uncle Fred answered briefly and absently that he thought that what she said was fine, fine. He agreed perfectly, and he was sure Emma did too. For emphasis, he looked his wife straight in the eyes and shook his head slowly up and down. Emma, still more slowly, imitated this movement. She found herself in agreement. Claire asked to be excused. She felt she could not bear to be present when Roger and her father came downstairs, when in all probability the ridiculous and pompous attitudes already developed in both camps would compound to form a little drama, militant and absurd. "Where are you going, dear?" Mrs. Boyne asked.
"I may go out. I'm not sure."
"Ah, out." The two syllables followed Claire in vague protest and reproach. Out was, in Mrs. Boyne's opinion, already and without further specification, a dubious, questionable place. Susan, who did not ask to be excused, simply left the room and caught up with Claire on the first landing.
"Silly," she said. "Why didn't you stay around? It was just getting funny."
"Why didn't you?" asked Claire sullenly.
"I didn't want to stay without you," Susan said. "Come on up to my room and let's talk."
"Aren't you going out tonight?"
"Not for an hour or so. Somebody's calling for me. A Dr. Einman, whom I've never met."
"Not met? Isn't that slightly unusual?"
"Not in these parlous times," said Susan. "People depute people to take people to parties. It's a shorthand symbol for the disintegration of all the better customs of society. We move toward anonymous vulgarity, lechery in blackouts, and so on. Civilization, war, and death."
She pirouetted neatly on the top step.
"Well, are you coming?"
she demanded then. Claire considered for a moment.
"All right," she said finally, "but only for a few minutes."
As they passed the closed door of their father's den, they heard tones of reproach, subdued shouts of anger, contrition, the unmistakable sound of a fist hitting a table.
"God," said Susan, with a sweeping gesture towards the door. "They ain't done right by our Nell."
3. As they entered the den, Mr. Boyne closed the door and settled himself in the leather chair. By fixing his gaze squarely on Roger's eyes, he gained what he conceived to be the advantage of keeping his son standing before him, the premium placed by amateur psychologists on superior height in such an interview was here outweighed by the fact that patience lasts longer sitting down. Mr. Boyne searched for a way to begin. He was not entirely certain as to what would be, for him, a desirable outcome of the interview, but he treated it from the first as a passage at arms in which his opponent, so he referred to his son, must be made to see the right thing, which meant that Roger, after being defeated, must be slightly humiliated as well.
"The Lord knows," he began at last,
If I'd known what a lot of trouble it would be, I never would have had a family.
The mildly humorous entrance to the subject was lost on Roger because of his own tension and because, as he was perfectly aware, his father resented trouble more than anything else, and perhaps as well. He did resent having a family and looked upon it as one of the trials that gave his Episcopalian universe a faintly Calvinistic tinge.
Now, I want you to know, Roger, before we begin, said Mr. Boyne, that I'm not inclined to treat this matter lightly, whatever the right and wrong of it. Divorce is a serious thing. There has never been a divorce in my family before, or anything remotely like it. No scandal, no really unhappy marriages.
This was not true, but Roger, in his present position, could scarcely make policy of it. Mr. Boyne continued,
I have always been strict with myself, Roger, very strict, in an ethical sense, I mean. I have taken care to be always honorable. I am a respected member of this community.
He paused, and Roger said,
Yes, sir,
in a low voice.
As for you, I have always allowed you more latitude, more freedom than I had myself. I did not want to play the heavy father with my children, although make no mistake, I would if it became necessary. I will if it does become necessary.
This had, so far as Roger could remember, formed the invariable prologue to these man-to-man talks that had marked, like irritants and poultices, the eruptive crises of his life. But in his boredom, it never occurred to him, he was in this way quite like his father, that this preamble took no account of the facts, never even asked for the facts of this particular case. Roger felt himself to be in the situation of a man who, on trial for his life on a murder charge, finds himself about to be convicted of the terrible crime of having presumed to be born at all. Heavily, Mr. Boyne followed the worn path.
I cannot conceal from you, Roger, that you have been a disappointment to me in many ways. I have wanted to talk to you for some time past. This business of the divorce is serious, yes, but it isn't the only thing that leads me to find fault with you. There is, to begin with, your treatment of your mother and myself, which has been careless and inconsiderate, to say the least. How do you think you made your mother feel when you spoke up before everyone about your wife's supposed or real infidelity? A matter that you should be almost ashamed to mention to me alone and should not whisper in your mother's hearing. Not only as your father, but simply as one man to another. Let me tell you, I resent your manner in speaking to her.
I thought it was my duty to tell you, sir,
mumbled Roger, conscious that it was a weak reply. Like a student who has tried to outguess the examiner, he had come prepared for catechizing on the subject of divorce and that alone. Now he realized the futility of this preparation against a sneak attack on the irrelevant foundations of his being.
It's rather late in the day for remembering your duty,
said Mr. Boyne, with broad sarcasm,
considering that you practically eloped in defiance of your mother's wishes 2 years ago. No such thing, sir. We merely assumed your permission from what was said and got married quietly.
With a fierceness close allied to tears, Roger took a stand on this open point.
Now, Roger,
Mr. Boyne made a temple of his fingers, rubbed their tips slowly together.
I do not wish to drive you into a lie. To me, a lie is a serious offense. I was 21 when I married. I'm 23 now. There is no law that permits you to dictate to me, sir. I can be free of you if I wish.
I do not want to embarrass you, Roger, by raising the question of your financial position. It is easy to talk about being free of me after taking my money. We will not mention that, however. I give you money freely of my own volition. You do not force me. I could hardly say it is your fault.
Roger was silent. Relentlessly, Mr. Boyne continued,
I do not pretend ever to have expected great things from you.
When you left college for the sole reason, apparently, that you fancied doing so, or did so out of a fear of expulsion if you remained, I said to myself, well now, wait and see. Perhaps he wants to get into the world, get to work. I could not have been more mistaken. But I let you go on. I gave you enough rope and more than enough. Now your life is a wreck. It's nobody's fault but your own. And you come to us expecting not only to be set on your feet, but to hear nothing about it afterwards, not one word of reproach.
He rose to his feet and commenced to walk about.
Have you ever put yourself out for me? Have I ever heard one word that would show me you appreciate what has been done for you, often at great expense and personal inconvenience? You have been, in my estimation, a ne'er-do-well, a spendthrift, and a wiseacre. You don't know how serious life is.
He sat down again, allowed a judicious silence, then went on.
But you're going to find out. You got married and you'll stay married. You want a divorce, but no money will be forthcoming from this house. For a while, I thought the country might go to war to help Britain. That would have been a horrible mistake, a direct contravention of the Monroe Doctrine. But you would have been in the army. In the army, they would have smartened you up, I'll say. But there'll be no war for us. We learned last time when we're well out of a thing. Perhaps you'll still get a year of it in the draft. And I tell you, I'll see to it there's no deferment in your case. Now, crying will get you nowhere.
This last remark, uttered in a tone of the most compulsive temper, was the only uncalculated statement of the speech. The factors that caused Roger to begin to cry have about them an interesting complicity. Tears were, in the first place, his only way of being heard. To have opposed his father with reasons, even had he any, would have invited the reproach of stubbornness. Having tried it, he knew that Mr. Boyne would simply say,
"Very well. You are not amenable to reason. Then I'll talk in a language you do understand."
And he would proceed to list again, in a louder voice and at greater length, the same catalogue of sins he had just finished reading. So even boredom was, in its way, a contributing cause to his tears. Then, as has been suggested, an emotional breakdown at this point amounted to a formal submission— a gesture of obedience which would make things easier from this point on, in this sense a dangerous kind of shortcut to the crisis and subsequent conciliation. Also, the years had established a pattern for these interviews which were like a folk drama in having been worn into shape by repetition, so that they illustrated not the oppositions and antagonisms of the moment, of the particular question, but more importantly and artistically, the tensions and conflicts that were permanently characteristic of the relation between father and son. It will be recalled that nothing of any practical significance had yet been said about the divorce. As for Mr. Boyne, this was to him as well the most difficult moment. All his efforts thus far had been directed simply at the result now achieved. To what extent, consciously or unconsciously, it would be impossible to say. His object had been to bring his son to the humiliation implicit in their relationship as both conceived it. But this submission had a double effect. Recognizing that he could now make unopposed any point he found desirable in particular, he was nevertheless shocked and embarrassed by his son's tears. A part of himself demanded and found them as a tribute, pleasant and ordinate. But another part insisted on rejecting these feelings as proper only to a certain low and bestial envy as not superior or judicious. There was something terribly, mysteriously womanish about their effect on one another, a conflict which was the other aspect of a slavery to love and fear, so that in the motions of the other felt a physical pull, a resistance that tore himself. In its practical conclusion, this climax always set in operation some law of diminishing returns. Mr. Boyne could never resist advantaging himself of his total victory by keeping Roger in tears for some time. but this inevitably meant that he must restore the boy's self to him by a capitulation on the practical point at issue. For a while longer, then, he kept his son there, crying quietly and saying yes to everything, while he went over in detail the list of life's crimes. Roger kept blubbering that he was sorry, which was perfectly true at the time, until Mr. Boyne felt a disgust and loathing for both of them that caused him to conclude the matter as rapidly as possible. The danger in this, he had found, was that he could, by generosity, by the reasonableness that followed on the collapse of his emotions, raise his son again to the point at which he could be respected. But for himself, no such thing. He left himself under an inexpiable and increasing burden of worry. Had he behaved bestially? What should he have done? Why did he always insist on this token victory that afterwards became so repellent to himself? He was convinced that there was some fundamental error in his ways, but he could not make it out by any means. In short, the doubly explosive capacities of the interview's first part had really the effect of reducing the difference between the parties to a readiness for agreement to almost anything, and the decision that finally would be made had already been prepared by the completest irrelevance. Now, the critical point over, they were able to discuss the question of divorce in the most dispassionate, if not actually amiable, manner. Mr. Boyne lit a cigar, Roger a cigarette. Both sat down.
"About Leonora's lapse," suggested Mr. Boyne, blushing slightly. "You have proof."
"Not proof, no," said Roger. "She goes out with a person named Jerry Landis."
"That won't get you a divorce."
"She told me she doesn't care for me."
"That's not evidence. Does she want a divorce?"
"I don't know. She won't sleep with me. I'm sure she likes Jerry better."
Mr. Boyne blushed again and considered. Desperately, he did not want to hear anything more. Desperately, in the line of patriarchal duty, he forced himself to ask another question.
Have you and Leonora always lived happily together?"
Roger blushed too, more perhaps at the euphemism than at the implication.
"I don't know, sir," he brought out in a strained voice. "I don't see how that could make anyone happy."
Despite himself, Mr. Boyne nodded sagely. He found himself perfectly agreed and felt that the worst moment was over.
"You won't get a divorce," he said.
"You haven't grounds, legally."
He settled back in his chair and proceeded to bring the discussion on to the less delicate realm of parable.
"Listen, son,"
he said earnestly.
"Suppose I told you that within 6 inches of your left arm in that drawer, there was a revolver. Suppose I said I bought it a long time ago in case I should ever have trouble of this sort. Suppose I said that when I was your age, I would have used it unhesitatingly. What would you say?"
Roger smiled slightly.
"I guess it's a question what you mean," he said. "Whether I'd blow my brains out or hers. It's a little hypothetical to me. I don't think I'd use it no matter what."
"I see,"
said his father somewhat stiffly.
"It doesn't mean that much to you, is that it? I know what you'll say. You'll call me melodramatic and old-fashioned. Perhaps so. But I was brought up, and most of my friends were brought up to believe in justice of a sort. That is, you would have to come to grips with life one time or another. If things started to slide, you couldn't just let them slide. You bought a gun and kept it. You knew you might have to use it someday. But you, I don't understand. You would never admit such a thing might be necessary. You would rather have another drink or go out driving. No, it's not funny. I mean it."
"You mean,"
said Roger,
"that you would have killed my mother simply to, well, save your pride?"
Yes,
said Mr. Boyne, realizing at the same time that he had never intended his parable to describe such a parabola, returning in this way to the personal, the applied. It was, he thought, a sweeping admission. Roger opened the drawer. There was no gun inside.
Just what did you mean me to think? He asked. That you would have done it? That you thought I should do it?
Mr. Boyne smiled, an incredibly devious Machiavellian smile.
I wanted to see what you would do, he said. As long as you thought there was a revolver in that drawer, you backed down. You thought it was just like a play. You didn't want to understand. And if you were faced with a disastrous situation, you preferred to degrade yourself by putting off the crisis. Now that everything is safe again, you ask me questions. That was all very well, Roger said, as long as I thought you had a revolver there. Now it seems a little pointless. A divorce means a lot, yes. It's not the same as murder. Besides, you might have behaved in the same way.
Being humiliated is a part of dying, said Mr. Boyne.
To me, if you don't feel that strongly about it, you don't want a divorce. You've made your bed, now lie in it.
The aptness of the metaphor struck him just after he had made it, and he coughed slightly.
I mean, he went on, that I cannot support you in it because it doesn't seem worth it to disgrace your whole family, in yourself, by dragging all this out in the open. And then again, he said vaguely, there's Uncle Fred.
With this, the discussion was over, though both felt that more might have been said. Particularly, Mr. Boyne remarked that he had, in a way, commended murder and wondered what his son thought. In point of fact, there had been a gun in the desk drawer until 2 years ago, when Mr. Boyne had sold it by way of capitulating to old age, and also, perhaps, in recognition of the safety conferred by the same. 4. The two girls were comfortably disposed in Susan's room, which was furnished, like the rest of the house, in a dark and saturnine fashion. Susan lay across the high canopied bed, almost concealed by maroon velvet hangings. Why a canopied bed in this room? No one knew. It had always been there. Claire sat in the only chair, which was, like herself, prim, straight-backed, and uneasy. The curtains, also of maroon velvet, were withdrawn, disclosing the narrow, lonely street at the corner of which a street lamp reflected brilliantly on a heap of dirty snow. Beyond, one could see a small part of the Charles River, and on the farther shore above the dark arc of the railway bridge, an illuminated sign advertising Carter's Ink. Claire was 21, 2 years older than her sister. She was tall, with heavy, pale blonde hair which she braided and coiled on her head. In repose, she was beautiful in that pre-Raphaelite conception of beauty that could be called by choice ethereal or bovine. It was statuesque. It was admirable, the fashionable word at the time. But one could not imagine it capable of warmth or great mobility. At best, an awkward, shy affection was predictable. And even this, concealed though it might be by good, even grand manners and a certain poise belonging to always threatened innocence, would be a source of self-torment and anxiety. Already she had developed a spinsterish asperity of voice, and on occasion, the primness of a young dowager. But Susan was small. Not fat, but not thin either. Beautifully well-formed, in fact, with black hair that she swept behind her ears and tied loosely at the nape of her neck. Her face was not beautiful, being too gross of feature, with somewhat thick lips, but her skin was pale and very white, shining like a light in bloodless wax, or with the waxen quality of flowers.
Poor Roger, Susan said now. What a beating he takes being the scion of the Boynes.
What do you suppose the real trouble is? Asked Claire.
Something sexual, I suppose.
Susan said it carelessly, yet with a slight emphasis on the fact of saying the word, of introducing a potent theme. What do you mean?
Well, Roger gave it a name. I suppose, maybe, that they just can't stand each other. How should I know? It all seems very disagreeable somehow.
But why does it have to be that especially?
Well, Susan said dully, Leonora's such a bitch, for one thing. Imagine how embarrassed Father must be. Have you noticed how he hates just the idea of sex? Uncle Fred would be the boy to enjoy himself, though. Lecherous old Uncle Fred that he is.
Really, Susan, why do you have to make these judgments, especially on your own family? People are the way they are.
I suppose so, Susan said. But I feel resentful.
Resentful? About what?
Well, call it about education. Doesn't it occur to you that all this, your intellectual qualities, Roger's drinking, even the way Fred treated Emma, that all this begins in bed, and this is the one thing we're supposed never to mention?
That seems, Claire said, sufficiently obvious. And so...
So it seems to me we're all being victimized by our own pretenses, pretending that we can do this and keep from doing that, and that it's all a matter of willpower and, well, education, when really we may be just blind activities started by two other blind activities having what they call fun.
But that would be just to deny yourself all individuality, Claire said excitedly. You would be just living in a dream.
Maybe I like it that way, said Susan with a teasing smile. Maybe I'm better off blind. And as for a dream, what do you call the other, this perpetual mooning about noble motives, when really, do you know, she asked suddenly, that we have a relative in the state asylum?
No.
Fred's brother. He tried to kill his wife long ago. He was a prime example. She died the year after he was put away, and they still keep telling each other she died of a broken heart because she couldn't live without him. Whether her heart was broken or not, she did it with a rope.
Suicide?
Yes.
How did you find out?
Leonora told me, and I put it up to Roger. He said that he'd gotten it from someone he'd met at the Napoleon Club. That doesn't matter. The point is, there's something so nasty and attractive about the idea of killing yourself because your husband can't murder you.
I don't see it, Claire said. She stood up and said angrily,
Why can't we keep our lives clean? Why is there this perpetual making of dirty jokes running like a soundtrack beside us, as though some horrible little toadstools were leaning together and whispering about us?
Maybe it's just built that way from the beginning, Susan said gravely. Built like a trap. But I don't know.
But why do we have to talk about it? Why do we have to admit it all the time?
Claire put up her hand to the window and felt the wonderful coolness, looked out at the river, the intermittent gleaming in its blackness. Her mind was full of images of coldness, of the magnificent vaulted solemnity of churches, convents, white stiff robes, coldness, centuries cold as the tomb devoted to denouncing warmth, intimacy. Even sweat might turn into ice, into sharp, delicate crystal spines.
It's life, Susan said, with a large gesture that seemed to add, take it or leave it.
Life. Claire laughed shortly and turned to her sister. You know all about it.
She surprised herself with boldness and said, Have you ever slept with anyone?
No, Susan said. No, I haven't.
Then don't sound so horribly clever. Life.
You mean you have?
Yes.
Claire had not meant to say this much, but now she continued.
I didn't like it. I wouldn't do it again, ever.
Maybe it would be different for you.
Ah, Claire, I'm sorry.
Susan came over and touched her sister's shoulder.
I'm sorry, she said again. I was just talking.
They stood together at the window.
A man and a woman were advancing up the street, leaning against the wind. In the shadows, they stopped to kiss briefly. Then she pushed him away, or so it seemed, and they walked on, disappearing under the window. A knock sounded at the door. Hogan's voice said that a Dr. Einman was waiting for Miss Susan.
"He has a taxi waiting, miss,"
Hogan added with respectful urgency. 5. After all, Roger thought, it could have been worse. He meant only that it could have gone on for another hour. Returning with his father to the living room and knowing...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.